Welcome back, everyone. I'm Cubits, the teacher, and if your case looks anything like this one by now, then you're the reason I got into education in the first place. If not, it's okay. My union's still got my back. So, it's finally styrene time. This is a big sheet I took from a damaged 50 by 70 centimeter frame, and I'm going to cut it down to size. If you found one the same size as your Strombi, then this next part is just pure entertainment for you. To cut the sheet to size, I'm using the backing panel from the frame to trace around. It's a nice thick material, so I can use my box cutter blade against it without going all wobbly. You don't have to cut all of the way through. A deep score is enough to get clean edges due to the brittle nature of the material. You'll notice that I've left the clear wrap on both sides. This will protect the shiny surface against scratches and won't be peeled off until right at the end of this build. By bending the sheet along the score marks, it easily splits with a clean edge. If you try to pull up and tear it like paper, you will create cracks, so just keep flexing it along the edges until the entire piece is free. Once it's all done, you can then use the knife to trim up the protective sheet. Now that it's all cleaned up, one more test fit is due. If it's slightly too large to fit the inner lip of the frame, you can just sand the offending edges down with regular sandpaper. Once it's all good to go, we can finally get on with the hard part. Okay, so now the sheet and frame are fitted to the case. This will keep everything nicely in place while we make some holes. You want to start with a small drill bit and use incredibly light pressure. A glass drill bit would be perfect as it effectively sands the cuts, but I'm just using a regular timber bit here. There will be some slight cracking, and it's okay as long as you keep them within the buttonhole areas. Really, use as little pressure as possible and let the bit heat up the styrene. A melted hole will stop cracks and create a crack-proof circumference. I'm using two hands here to hold the drill, with my bottom hand working as a jack to keep the force off the drill bit. A drill press would be awesome for doing this. This work takes quite a while, but rushing will ruin the whole job, and you've got 9 of these holes to do. So go easy. Right, now that the pilots are drilled, it's time to open them up. For this, I'm using these rough shaping bits. Alternatively, you could use a Dremel with a sanding disc, or even a hot wire if you have proper shop ventilation. If you are cutting this stuff with heat, you really don't want to be inhaling the vapor. In the future, I might do a video showing off the hot wire method. It's super quick. Anyway, so again, it's all about a little pressure and big RPM. The heat generated from the bit will melt the plastic and allow the bit to pass through the styrene. Once this happens, it'll seal any cracks you've created with the pilot holes to stop them from spreading later. Once the hole is opened up to the edge of the wood, you can easily snap off any of the brittle swarf which remains around the hole. Alternatively, a little rub of sandpaper around the inside of the hole will clean it up almost instantly. Repeat this 8 more times and you've almost got an arcade stick. To clean up the case a little, I masked the top and bottom panels off with some tape and gave the whole thing a blow over with a couple of layers of white spray paint. I usually go with an all black motif because it just blends in so well, but with a silver frame, a white Wiimote and lighter art, I thought this would be a nice change. The last bit of woodworking left is the mounting of the joystick. To more easily line up the screws, I've taken the plate off of this Sanwar JLF to use as a template. The bolts I'm using are these dinky guys I found at the hardware store. While you can get a set of bolts bundled in with your joystick purchase, these are significantly cheaper to pick up. The holes we'll be drilling should be just bigger than the diameter of the screw. It should pop into the hole but not wiggle about. You can fuss around with measurements to align your joystick perfectly, but a degree here or there never really affected anyone when it comes to a digital joystick. A good eyeballing should be good enough. Just because of the awkward camera placement, I partially drilled the holes before removing the template and finishing the job. At home, you can probably just do it all in one go. Testing the bolt fit, it's spot on. Now, let's get to work on the top side. So for this part, we want to create nice flush countersinks for these bolt heads. To do that, I just use a really big drill bit, like this one. The trick here is to put your drill in reverse direction. This will still cut the wood slowly, but it eliminates any risk of chewing through the timber and ruining the whole project. Quadruple check this setting before you drill. Then you just apply some pressure and drill away until the countersink is deep enough. Now the bolts should just press in from the top and sit flush with the rest of the top panel. Flip it over and the joystick should just slip into place on the pins. These tiny nuts can be a bit fiddly. Just screw them down by hand onto each of the bolts, but not too tight so the stick can still be adjusted. Once that's done, you can flip the case back over to center the stick, and with a fingernail against the bolt, use a screwdriver to tighten it down. Repeat for each of the remaining bolts while you hold the stick in place, and it should be nice and secure. Sorry, I did this part off screen, just because I couldn't fit everything into view. But now we have a solid stick, ready to bust out some mad DPs. Well, that's enough learning for today. Drop in tomorrow to find out how to turn this disgusting mess into this vision of perfection, and finally inject some brains into that beautiful body you've worked so hard on. Remember to subscribe and/or like, and I'll catch you on the flip side.